Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Soul Booth. It looks, I know, like I'm woefully alone today in my little booth, but that is not the case. In fact, it's never the case because there are always two people behind the scenes when I'm shooting these segments who make it possible. I couldn't do it without them, and today I'm turning the camera on them, and they are my guests in the Soul Booth. So, meet Marie and Meaghan. Okay, girls, come on in. Leave those cameras. We're going to be on autopilot today. You're in the booth.
I'm in the booth.
How? Okay, get seated. Get comfortable. And then tell me, how does it feel in the booth?
Oh, it feels nice.
It feels soulful, baby.
How did you get hooked up with this crazy project?
You met Nancy. I didn't meet Nancy.
At the Cinevex National Dinner. Mm-hmm. Where it all began. We had the Cinevex National Dinner in, what was it, November?
Yeah.
And you were emceeing it. And I was like, this lady's crazy. You're
like, I want to be a friend. Yeah. So that's what happened. She
came up and said, okay, we have to be friends. Yeah. We both went to San
Diego. I have no friends, so I would like a friend.
Yeah. And then you also told me that your sister just broke her neck and was in a halo. And I was like, what's a halo? Yeah. And who is this girl?
It's always too casual of a conversation.
Yeah.
Which is my problem.
Yeah.
No, I didn't go to the national dinner because I was in the hospital because I broke my neck. And by broke, like, have you seen Mean Girls, the movie Mean Girls?
Yeah.
Are you pretending?
Yeah, I'm pretending. I haven't seen it. I'm 51. I haven't seen Mean Girls.
Mean Girls, at the end of the movie, one of the main actresses gets hit by a bus and she wears a halo. She's, like, geared, like, neck to toe, like with a whole
Regina George.
When I tell people that I was in a halo, they're like, no, that's just off that movie. Like, that's not for real. Like, that's not actually a real thing.
That's a pretend.
And then
thing.
People don't it's understand that there's four screws that go into the screw.
Let's go to the video.
Okay.
So I have a halo. Right?
True.
Hit it! My name is Marie and this is Meaghan, and we are identical twin sisters, if you can't tell. And we decided to start a video series called Twin Talks. In this video, we're gonna be talking about living with a halo. So basically, I had kind of a fall, pretty bad, tumble down a hill, and I fractured my C1 and my C7. My C1 looks like it just went.
When we were talking about living with a halo,
I'm really not living with
you
a halo.
You think you're living
with a halo. I'm living with a person with a halo.
She acts like she's the one living with the halo.
Right. Let's play that game. Here we go.
There's a lot of bad things. My throat being more annoying. However, we've chosen to be optimistic and tell you about why living with a halo is great.
It's awesome!
Basically, we're halo ambassadors.
That's we are brand ambassadors for halo.
The first reason why living with a halo is amazing
awesome
is because it differentiates twin sisters.
Yes.
You can tell us apart. No more of this. Which one's Marie? Which one's Meaghan? Marie's the one living with a halo. Meaghan doesn't have a halo. Marie's gonna have some scars. Meaghan's not gonna have some scars. Marie's gonna look like I'm Frankenstein. Meaghan's not gonna look like Frankenstein.
Here's a nice little view for you. Get right in there.
So,
you're welcome.
Be grateful.
Bless up.
I have an accessible washroom these days. It's safer.
Comfortable.
It looks like your 90-year-old grandmother's bathroom, but that's okay.
Oh, there's the morphine alarm.
Beyonce basically wrote a song for me.
It's fair.
Like Snapchat filters.
The halo filter.
Is it a halo?
It's like a flower.
We use it as a halo.
Okay, so the hilarious thing is, that video has how many views on YouTube?
Oh, I don't know. Like, it's more on Facebook because we posted it on Facebook.
Probably like close
the
to
algorithms, you know?
15, maybe 20,000.
Yeah.
I show it to people.
So it's amplified.
Yeah, well, that's it.
Of course.
I'm amplifying. I show it to people because I want to show them who you are. Mm. And I know that when they see that video, they're going to see your energy, enthusiasm, yes, positivity,
yes,
humor,
yes,
craziness. You know what I forgot to mention?
Mm-hmm.
They're identical twins.
Yes.
In case you haven't figured it out yet.
True.
Okay, so at St. Evex, you started shooting video, and I think you made yourselves indispensable, basically, right? You created a job for yourselves there.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. But we graduated high school early and then went backpack New Zealand for a bit.
Oh, before university.
Yes. And it was one of those things where, like, it's like your parent always knows what's best for you. Mm-hmm. And Dad was, like, a financial advisor. He was, like, because we were kind of into photography a little bit. And then, so we were shooting nice photos. So we did a nice camera. And then Dad was, like, I'd love to see some videos. And we're, like, Dad. Like, screw off, Dad. You don't know what you're talking about. And then went to New Zealand. And then he basically, like, snuck a little dingy, like, Canon, like, I don't even know what they're called, the small ones. And we started making, like, video montages of our trip. Mm-hmm. And it was, like, awful quality. It was, like, 480 or something like that. And then St. Evex recognized it, and they were like, you're crazy. We want you to interview people.
So we did videos for St. Evex for 4 years on and off camera. Mm-hmm. So we were behind the scenes and interviewing on the people. Scenes. I don't know what you call it. On the scenes?
Yeah. Professional, not us. Yeah.
In front of the camera?
Yeah. And then we just started making, like, a ton of videos. So it was, like, interview videos. And then we just started making, like, extering videos. And then that was the other thing. Dad was like, you can make money off this. We're like, Dad. We're like, no, come on. What are you talking about?
We're just having fun.
Yeah. And then he was like, you could do weddings, you could do, like, corporate stuff. And we were like, Dad. One of our professors actually at St. Evex was like, no, like, you should really take this seriously. And then we started doing it. And then we were just, like, back and forth from Halifax. Like, our friends will tell
our
you.
Our goal was to be on the Soul Booth.
Yeah, that was the goal. Here we are, the dream. Thank you, Lord.
You know, I love that you set that goal even before it existed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's good.
That's right.
They always say there's a psychic thing between twins. I didn't know you were psychic outwardly.
Yes.
But do you read each other's minds?
That's actually, we have a video series called Twin Talks. Mm-hmm. And the first was Living with a Halo, you saw earlier.
Yes.
And then the second is going to be Shit People Say to Twins.
We'll beat that out.
And so we're going to use we're going to reiterate that in the video.
Oh.
But I don't know. I think we just have, like, a lot of emotional empathy for one another.
Like, the whole Halo thing was...
Yeah.
Pretty bad.
Yeah. Okay.
It's kind of like I fell, you know?
Yeah. So, it's like you fell. Like you say in the in the video, right? Let's feel badly for Meaghan.
What about
me?
Because
her twin broke the neck.
Come on.
But, okay, so seriously, that was... We can joke about it now, and you did in that video.
Yeah.
But that's... Crazy. It's A, amazing that you lived, right? You broke C1...
C2,
C6, C7.
All the C's.
So, and typically, if somebody usually had that kind of an accident and break, they would either not live or they would be paralyzed for life. Is that right?
Yeah. It's, like, very rare to come out, especially your C1, right? Because it's, like, connected to your brainstem. So it's very rare to come out.
Yeah.
It's funny because, like, a lot of people, like, when you say, like, when I say to people, like, I broke my C1, C2, C6, C7. Such a mouthful. A lot of people that aren't in the health professions don't really know what that means. And I mean, I wouldn't either, but if you speak to somebody who's a health professional, they would be like, and you're walking?
There were
resident doctors that would come in my room and be like, this is the girl that broke her C1. Like,
we won't get into the details, but you fell down a hill and hit your head and broke the neck.
Right.
I want to know about when you woke up. What was the first thing you remember?
Everything's kind of hazy because I was in the hospital. It was pretty late at night. But when I actually woke up and I was, like, 100%, like, conscious, I woke up. It must have been, like, 6 a.m. or something in the hospital. And I remember my neck brace being on and being, like looking over and seeing the monitor and being, And she wasn't there because she slept at a friend's house that night or whatever. And, eventually she came, like, probably, like, an hour after or something.
Yeah.
But
they told me to go home when we went to the hospital that night. They were like, go home, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
X-rays aren't showing up.
Yeah.
And come back in the morning. I brought coffees and I was like, this is a joke. Like, this sucks. It's all going to be fine.
Oh.
And then I showed up at the hospital and they were like, you need to sit down. Like, this is really bad.
Yeah.
Really.
So I remember waking up and my neck, like, killing. Obviously, it was on, like, a huge amount of... morphine.
Mm-hmm.
I remember waking up and being like, I'm just gonna shut my eyes again. I'm gonna save this for a couple hours.
Literally.
I'll take on the world in 2 hours.
Yeah.
Two more hours of sleep and I'll be good.
Yeah. Can't deal with it right now.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Go and then the phone starts ringing. And then it was
Meaghan was ringing
for 2 months.
Meaghan was my, like, secretary.
Communications
agent.
You can endorse me on LinkedIn.
I can only imagine what your description is on LinkedIn. Literally. All the things you could be endorsed for. Yes. I can't even conceive
Halo ambassadors.
It. Yeah.
Number one.
Anyways, so yeah. What was it like for you when they said, you got to sit down and here's the deal?
I called Dad and I was like, I think this is really bad. And then they came back and they kind of explained it to me. And when they said that the doctor was straight up like, she should be dead. Mm-hmm. I was like, no, what? Come on. Don't exaggerate. Did she tell you that? Like,
she told you to say that, didn't she?
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, so it was bad. And then they were debating if she should be airlifted to Halifax. And then she ended up taking the ambulance. And then she was in the hospital for 5 weeks. And then a halo for 3 months.
So when they said to you, you know, she should be dead.
Yeah, yeah.
The seriousness of it sunk in.
Yeah.
And how was that for you, given how close the two of you are?
Yeah. So what I was, like, what I always say to people is, like, being 23, it's like we've had, like, two crazy traumatic life experiences. Number one, mom passing away when we were 14 from cancer. And then this. So it's like life or death. Like, mom's outcome was death. Mm-hmm. And then this outcome was life. So to, like, contrast those. Mm-hmm. And to also, like, be so close. Like, Marie and I, like, I know we joke, but, like, we literally do everything together. Like, we have the same video, like, we work in the video production company, we took all the same classes in school, like, we love, and we, like, fully embrace it, we milk the twin thing. So it was, like, really weird to, like, think about it, and, like, I even say, like, those were, like, such sad times, like, walking to the hospital and stuff. Had to wear sunglasses, like, every time. I used to go to the hospital, like, two times a day. Mm-hmm. I'd be, like, this easily could have gone wrong. Like, whatever it was, millimeters could have gone wrong.
So I met you after this happened, mm-hmm. but have you always both been so positive and enthusiastic?
Mom was like that. Like, mom was, like, crazy. Mom was, like, us double, honestly.
Which I don't know if that's possible.
She was, like, so bubbly. And, like, also another thing, too, is, like, she really taught us how to grieve because her brother passed away when he was in his 20s.
Oh,
and we weren't around, but, like, she would embrace it.
That was David Jones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And she Dartmouth and everybody. I mean, it's like the whole city knew.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the family and that.
Yeah. We always talk about it, too. It was like, and, like, you say that there's no such thing as coincidences, which is kind of like how, like, this kind of works is, like,
take that.
Mom literally, like, she, like, you know, loved a good cry. And she embraced it. Mm. And she embraced it even though, like, he passed away, you know, whatever it was, like, 20 years, 10 years, like, beforehand. She still would, like, you know, grieve and stuff. And so it was, like, her grieving taught us how to grieve.
And she showed you
it was not only
okay, but you're supposed to
grieve.
And then, of course, you needed that for when she died.
Yeah, totally.
And there's a, I don't know if you're familiar with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. I think she's a psychologist, but she developed a theory on grief, and there's five stages to grieving, which a lot of people are familiar with. I don't remember if I'll name them all, but there's depression and denial and acceptance and anger and bargaining.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And all of those five, like, you can, it's, there's no, like, this year you go through depression. This year, it's like by the day, sometimes you experience all those five emotions. I wrote an article about it maybe a year ago on grieving about mom and talking about how it's so important to embrace every one of those stages.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, I put in our own examples, like bargaining, like when mom was sick, we were like bargaining for her life. And,
please!
Jesus! But also, like, depression, like, obviously severely depressed, like, when mom died, and then acceptance, like, realizing, like, what happened, and then anger, like, being mad that she wasn't there for, like, graduation, all these things, but, like, at the end of the day, like, you find, in your weakest moments in life, like, it's still possible to find happiness.
Whoa!
Deep. That's good. She's the deep one.
Soulful.
She's the soulful
That's
twin.
That's why we're here.
Yeah. No. Absolutely.
No. Totally.
But I love what you're saying, and I guess the way I think of it is that grief has shocked me at learning about it firsthand, in that you realize you have to just go on. You know, you have that first stage where you're just a total mess, whatever. Yeah. But at some point you have to go on.
Yeah.
And you manage to put a lid on, it's like this well of grief. And you put a lid on it and you go about your life. And then one day you're just doing some little thing and something knocks the lid off the well. And it's like, so whoa, it is so full and so deep. Yeah. And then you just, and I could cry now just talking about it.
Yeah.
Because it's that access it gives you again to that depth of emotion inside.
And it builds that.
Take that.
Yeah.
I'm teaching you so
much.
Man,
like our grandfather passed away about a month ago. And Meaghan was in Costa Rica on a surf camp. And people ask me why I wasn't there. I'm like, hello, the neck, remember? Yeah. But anyways.
You were resilient, but surfing with the halo would not have gone over well.
It would be so positive.
I say yo-ho, you only hear it once, hopefully. My grandmother asked me to sit in the front of the funeral with her. At the funeral with her. And I start sobbing because Eagle's Wings starts playing. That song was at my mother's funeral. Mm. I was sitting in the same spot in the same church. I literally like lost it. But Nanny looked at me and she was crying too. And she goes, don't you just love a good cry? And I'm like, that is the truth.
Oh, man,
like,
and it's what your mom would have said too, right?
Totally. Yeah.
And I don't know if you remember, that's what Anne Berube said. She asks her clients, when was the last time you cried until you were done?
Yeah.
And it is. It's like, whoa, that's so true. We always stifle it. We shut ourselves down.
Right. It's important to embrace every one of those stages.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's the thing, like life, like, I don't know, we're going to get real deep here. Life, I mean, like, it's not supposed to be perfect. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You're supposed to deal with stuff. And maybe you don't lose your mom at a young age to that extent. Or, like, you know, everyone's got their stuff. But, like, it's supposed to be like this.
We say everything
you're supposed to learn.
Everything happens for a reason. And if it doesn't, we're all screwed.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's so true. And I think that there's a lot of truth in the idea that we grow from our lessons, our hardships, you know?
Yeah.
And if you look back at the end of your life, you realize that in some way, a lot of the really tough things that you went through made you, it's like a diamond, you know, they can only occur because so much pressure was applied to them. And it creates character and it teaches you a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's hard to look back and say, look, we lost our mom at 14 and that had to happen.
Yeah.
You know, that's like,
right.
You don't want to go there.
Right.
But she was an extraordinary woman. By all accounts.
Mm.
Tell me about her.
She's like you. She's you, but blonde.
Oh my God.
Yeah, literally. Just different visual.
Exactly.
Oh my God. Okay, so what I need to explain is that although I've only known these guys I've only known Marie for less than 2 months.
Yeah.
We have a really great connection.
So much.
And they joke that I'm okay. You have a lot of other mothers. How many other mothers?
This is the thing. Mother's Day is coming up.
Don't tell. They'll all be
Everyone will be jealous that we're hanging out.
Yeah, it's okay. Let them know.
It's funny because like Mother's Day is coming up, and everyone's like, oh, Mother's Day. Like, we shouldn't talk about it for the twins. Like, so hard. Like, we have like family parties and like all the aunts and uncles and stuff. We're like, Mother's Day is exhausting. We have like 30 moms. Like, literally, we have a mom in New Zealand. We have a mom in Switzerland. We have a mom in Halifax. We got, like, 10 moms in Halifax.
Yeah, I thought I was your 32nd mom.
Yeah,
32nd.
You said I was number 32. You told me when we first connected that you had 31 moms. And so I'm like, oh, so I'm the 32nd when you told me I was like your mom. And then I decided that was also...
fudge.
That now I also say I'm your 32nd mom, which means I get to give you advice in 32nd snippets.
32 seconds.
Right? Like the other day I said... Meaghan, for God's sake, you got to change your voicemail. You are the most positive, energetic, fabulous person. And
hey,
your voicemail's like, hey, it's Meaghan. Call me. I'll call you back. Leave a message. I'm like, okay, you got to up your game.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
But it was just 30-second little snippet of advice.
Yeah,
it's good.
Little calls. You
got to take that. Yeah. We have lots of moms, so.
How does your dad feel about all your moms? Does he feel threatened by...
Well, I mean, like, his fiance right now...
She's up there for the moment.
Dawn is very much up there. She's awesome.
Yeah.
But
Dad is actually...
Dad can't keep up.
Dad is actually... Like, I feel like when Mom died, Dad became a mom.
Oh, well. Totally.
Like, he's a combo.
Yeah, yeah.
Dad just has such a fatherly but also motherly presence about him.
Mm-hmm.
And he kind of stepped in.
When Mom passed, it was like Dad had no option. He had to transform into Mom, basically. And now he's like... We tell Dad everything. We call Dad every day. Like, he's literally, like, my favorite person in the whole world.
Yeah.
He's literally become mom. Like, but he didn't have an option. He had no choice.
Yeah.
So he's just naturally nurturing.
Yeah. He's like the nicest, the
most nurturing,
most genuine person you'll ever meet. Random. He's as random as we are.
That scares me.
Yeah.
Is he really?
Like, yeah. So random. We make fun of him. Yeah.
I think a lot of people had my reaction, like, okay, your mom, Paula, was clearly working for you and taking care of you when that happened for you to have, you know, survived in the way you did and be walking around after a few months.
Totally.
Yeah.
Do you feel that?
From mom passing away, like, it was, like, frig, like, almost 9 years ago?
Nine years ago.
Like, I was, like, always looking for signs. Always. And I never really, like, it's one of those things where, like, you're like, oh, she's probably here, like, you can feel her, like, whatever. I mean, there was one time, like, I paddled competitively in, like, one nationals, and, like, I remember, like, thinking, like, I can, like, feel. But there's been, honestly, a lot of points where I've been, like, disappointed, where, like, I'm like, where's the sign? Which, like, there is signs.
The grieving. Go back to the grieving.
There is signs and stuff, but, like, there was, like, I don't know, there's, like, I don't know, you see in the movies, like, moving stuff or, like, whatever, and, like, certainly I can, like, feel, like, I feel like she would be present, but, like, I think that this was, like, that thing that I was, like, holy crap, because, like, I don't know if you, like, we went to church and we got confirmed, and, you know, our grandfather was the church police, so he would be very mad to hear that, hear me talking about this, but, you know, like, I don't know if I identify as a super religious person. And so I definitely think that there's something more, but then it was like, you know, when the doctors were like, she should be dead.
Yeah.
Like, it makes no sense.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm like, that is the thing. Like, that's it.
Our aunt, who's pretty religious, she says she's okay with the fact that we don't go to church and we're not super religious, even though we come from a very religious family.
Yeah.
She says, as long as you believe in something,
mm-hmm.
and the whole... the notion of something that is 4D, more so like spirits, or like you can feel... the presence, and like the fact that like I nearly died and I don't even know what the stakes are, like, insane. Obviously mom was there, like,
yeah,
God, I
totally.
Had hopefully had some sort of more purpose to my life that I had to pursue past that moment in time, because otherwise, you know. And like, I mean, like, we joke about the halo and like it's all fun and games, but at the end of the day, like, there were some bad times. Going back to, like, mom passing away and going through that and being a stronger person because of that, like, and reflecting on that while I was recovering in the hospital, like, thank God I had that, because I used that as fuel to, like, motivate myself to push.
She was so positive. It was actually insane. Like, I had hip surgery, like, a year and a half ago, and I was the biggest baby ever. I had a huge hip brace and crutches for 6 weeks, and it was, like, a running joke. And then Marie, like, should be dead and is in the halo with 4 screws in her skull for friggin' 3 months.
But there,
like,
were times,
resiliency.
Like, totally. I know we say, like, I know it's so easy to say, like, to push back and to be strong and whatever, but it's not easy for a lot of people, and it wasn't easy for us. We just, like, make it look like it was easy on social media or whatever, the way you portray it.
Thank you, Taylor.
There were some dark times, man. Mm-hmm. Like, we both struggled. Like, I remember being in the hospital at 3 a.m. and sobbing my face off.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, just, like, morphine withdrawal for 3 weeks. Like, I had anxiety through the roof.
Hulk.
But, like, in those moments,
triplet.
If you let them happen and, like, you deal with those, like, negative obstacles and, I mean, like, take them and be sad and be angry and feel those, but then afterwards reflect and be like, this is still life and we're still in it. And then I always think back to mom, always. So, like, God, I hope she's here.
Blocked over there.
Yeah, exactly. No, I think she's in the room. There's no question about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's what that makes me think of. I feel like there is an epidemic of depression and anxiety among teenagers today.
100%.
I hear so many kids who are struggling. And recently I heard about a university stat from someone who happened to be at that university saying, like, 30% of the kids have anxiety,
totally,
depression.
Doesn't surprise me at all.
So given everything you've been through,
mm-hmm.
How do you think you escaped that? Is it because you confronted your real emotion and your mom taught you how to grieve and you didn't bottle it all up? Or what's your secret?
There are like two things. I think number one, obviously, is like the experience of mom and like learning, obviously, how to embrace it.
You got to go through the bad to
get the good. You just got
it. And it's too bad because it takes really horrible things to happen to people for them to wake up sometimes. And that's not always the case. But yeah, sorry.
I would say, like, just that's the thing. And, like, that's what people need to just think more about. And, like, certainly, like, mental illness is a whole different story. But the thing is, like, life is not supposed to be perfect. Life is not perfect. That's the point of life. And you need to go through all that stuff. You need to embrace it because we look back in the halo and we laugh at it. It was really hard, but, like, it's a story. It, like, made Marie grow. Like, it's amazing. Like, you need to just totally embrace everything. Like, you need to be as obsessed with the good as the bad. Because there's so much to be learned from both. But then the second thing is we cheated the system. We're twins.
Yeah.
There's two of us. We had each other.
We had each other.
It was so easy because we had each other. Like, this separate... Yeah. We're just so lucky. And that's the other thing. Like, you talk about coincidences aren't a thing. Mm-hmm. Maybe we were meant to be twins. Mm-hmm. To go through all this freaking shit. Right. Yeah.
But I do think, like, mental illness is a whole other thing. Like, totally. It's easy to be like, oh, push back and recover and be strong. But mental illness is mental illness. Like, at the end of the day, like, you need professional help for some of that sort of stuff. So.
But do you see it in your, age group?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Why do you think it is?
I don't know. I think it's
there's just a lot of pressures and stuff, especially with social media. That's like a whole other convo.
We're going to actually do that convo in a future Soul Booth with a child psychiatrist who's, you know, really on the front lines.
Yeah.
And so stay tuned for that.
Stay tuned for sure.
You guys will be interested in that, I know. Yeah. But I think it's amazing that you've been out of university for a year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, a year as of, like, today, pretty well.
Yeah.
Okay.
We graduated our exams a year probably from today. Yeah.
You have your own business called Mirror Image Media. Mm-hmm. Mirror Image. Twins.
Yeah, that's the twin thing.
Took me a while to get that. I thought I'd help people. And you're going gangbusters. And I always say that you two defy every generalization there is about millennials. Millennials have a bad rap, right?
Yeah.
They say, you're supposed to brag yourself up all the time.
I'm serious because you are, I mean, you're so hardworking and ambitious and motivated, and you are way more efficient than I am. That's true.
Bigger as you speak.
Yeah. No, you're so efficient. Wow. So you're really rocking it. What's your secret?
What's the secret?
Once again,
Nancy Regan's fudge.
Yeah. they're powered by my fudge.
We are.
Brought to you by Nancy Regan's fudge before we came in.
Yeah.
Is that the only reason
you're doing the Soul Booth?
Because it's the only reason.
Let's be clear. These two 23-year-olds are shooting this project for me for free.
In return for, like,
fudge
and CTV
time
and, like, huge networks.
Some consulting I'm doing
and
with
to hang
you.
Out.
No, but I think it's partly because you love the concept as well, right?
Yeah, 100%.
Oh, we drank the Kool-Aid, baby.
Yeah, totally.
It matches your positive energy.
It's not all about money.
Yeah.
That's the other thing.
Yeah.
It's not about money.
Okay, let's just talk
very briefly
about why you're leaving me for 4 to 6 weeks.
Like children.
I don't know how I'm going to do this. I'm going to have to come out on the road with you, I think.
Please. I thought you were coming.
Yeah, I might. I might show up. Careful what you wish for.
It's like that crazy mom that's like, where are you? I'm in Ottawa.
True.
No, or my friend who, when her son went on a bike trip across Canada, She drove along. She drove behind them the whole way.
No,
it's true.
Okay.
My name is Linda.
I'm the 32nd mother. Hey, over here.
I would make up signs for my car and everything. The 32nd mother. That could be a thing. I could do a whole other podcast.
Yeah.
Okay, so where are you going and why?
We are going. Okay, so we're making a documentary called The Social Shift.
Mm-hmm.
So we're making it with a friend of ours. His name is Joseph, and it's through our three of our perspective. There's another one of our good friends, Kevin Courtney. He's coming along. He's going to be one of the filmmakers as well. But it's called The Social Shift because we work for a company called Common Good Solutions. So essentially, they help start, grow, and connect social enterprises. So a social enterprise is a business that is doing good through the community, basically, in simple terms.
Love it.
Whether that be through like environmental, cultural, or social impact. So we noticed that there is quite a lot of social enterprise activity happening in Nova Scotia. And because the company that we work for has connections across the country, we realized that this is a bigger story than Nova Scotia. So it's kind of through our perspective as millennials, trying to figure it out, trying to widen the exposure of this whole sector that we didn't really know about. So like as business grads, we learned a lot about like corporate social responsibility and some social impact and stuff. Mm-hmm. But when we were exposed to Common Good Solutions, we were like, how do we not know about this? Like this whole social enterprise thing, like it aligns with our values. So anyways, we're flying to Vancouver May 8th. We're buying an RV and we're driving it across the country back to Nova Scotia. And on our drive, we're featuring just really cool people doing really cool things.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's going to be fun.
I was going to say, you're not going to have any fun at all.
We're invited, so.
You are formally going to take the country by storm. I can't even imagine. They don't know. Canada doesn't know what it's in for.
Yeah. Be careful. Justin Trudeau, where are you at?
I know. We're trying to get Trudeau.
I know. Trudeau. Whose idea was that?
Yours.
Whose idea was that?
Yours.
Well, why wouldn't he want to meet you? Well, you're fabulous.
People say it's ambitious, but people say the whole documentary is ambitious. Yeah. And it is ambitious. Like, if it wasn't ambitious, everybody would be doing it if it was easy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's a lot, but we've raised half the amount that we need, and we're going to raise more, and it's going
to
be great.
Okay, and if anybody watching this wants to give you a donation of $100 or more.
Or fudge.
I am going to make them fudge.
She's going to make
them fudge. Personally make them my famous Doozy's fudge.
And then they'll drink the Kool-Aid and they'll be in the booth.
And then that's it. And then they'll be in the booth. Maybe you never know. But no. Anybody gives you $100 or more for this trip, I am totally making them fudge.
That fudge is
www.thesocialshift.ca.
That's right. Yeah. It's worth $100. Okay. To wrap up, I want you to tell me her best trait.
Trait.
Do you know what that means?
Organization.
Be nice.
Organization. No, Marie's really mature. No, Marie, you know what? Marie is actually immature. However, I'm just more immature. She's very on the game.
What a great compliment that was.
You're going to make me cry.
Like, for
so
instance.
Sweet.
For instance, here's an example. Halo mode. Marie was probably doing more of the cooking than me.
I'm glad she openly admits that on camera.
This is the first time that I've admitted it. But you need to have that balance.
I thought all your mothers were giving you food.
They were.
That's kind of true. Yeah. I don't know.
The cleaning, cooking.
No, best. No, Marie. Yeah. I don't want to be all gushy with
Marie. Be gushy. Come on. So your last chance. You're going to look back at this when you're 30.
You're resilient. We never, like, we'll, like, sometimes hug, but we always just fist bump because we get, like, we never want to be, like, super.
We cry too much.
Yeah, we just cry too much.
Do you?
Like, sometimes she'll just be,
I know. And it's either or. Like, sometimes, like, this is a whole other conversation, but sometimes, like, Marie will be, like, really sad about mom or something. I'll come in, I'm all, like, wired up. And I'll come in, I'm like, Marie, put it away. Other times it's, like, the opposite. We're never on the same page.
Except if you cry, usually. I, like,
empathy problems.
I'm glad the Halo thing didn't happen to this one. Not for the fact that she would be a little bit struggling more.
Yeah.
A little bit more demanding. Love ya. But also for the fact that I don't think I could possibly be in the position she was in.
Yeah, the empathy. Oh, you should have seen us, like, in the hospital. The nurses, like, they thought it was so cute to be like, because I wasn't allowed to sleep over. Which is like, come on.
Really?
We should. Really?
You weren't allowed
Here's
to.
Here's hospitals. Dear hospitals. Let twins sleep.
Your womb mates.
Exactly. Mates of the womb.
Okay, that was your
that was
expression
yeah,
that
don't
I was
try
like,
to
oh,
see
I've
that.
Never heard that before. I love it. They're womb mates.
But like, even us, like it would be like 11 o'clock at night, and Marie would have anxiety with the morphine and blah, blah, blah. And she'd have to walk around, like, move, and like, she'd do laps. And I would just hold Marie's hand, and we just do laps. You see these twins just doing laps.
Those were dark days.
It's like a movie. Mm-hmm. It was like so,
sad, but they have an empathy problem.
Okay, so what about her?
Oh. Yeah, give me a compliment, would you, for one?
Loud!
I'm just kidding. Pimple-free!
Aww!
Cutty.
That's savage. The difference right there. She would say that.
That's it. Mic drop.
Listen, just because I look like a potato and pizza's on my face.
Oh, my gosh.
I would say, obviously, very, our relationship is a whole, like, I could give that a million words. But I would say, in general, Megan's extremely driven. Like, we'll get, but we'll get shit done. Like, yeah. if she would pick up the phone and call somebody and be like, yo, you want a video? We're going to do it right now. Like, or, like, anything with business, anything with school, like, she's super driven. And also driven when it comes to sticking up for me. Or, like, when I was in the hospital, there was an incident, and I won't publicly talk about it.
Will you not, though?
One of the resident doctors was going to send me home the night that it happened, or the night after that it happened. And I was like, I don't feel comfortable because it takes three people to carry me to the bathroom. So then she obviously steps in and is like, No. I'm going to tell you what's about to happen.
Not even that. There was one night that she was kept buzzing. And obviously, like, it's hard because the nurse-to-patient ratio, it's difficult, oh, yeah, right? So there was one night, and anyway, she kept bringing the buzzing the thing. And she basically was texting me. It was 12 at night. She basically was texting me, not overtly saying, but she was basically saying, I feel extremely vulnerable, mm-hmm. and I don't feel comfortable here. And I can't advocate for myself.
And I was in a lot of pain waiting for pain meds.
I was like, get on the phone, like, telling people off. Superman. Get me the manager. Superman, nurse. That's what it is. Next day, the nursing manager comes in, and she knew mom, because mom was a nurse, which was crazy that she found that out. Like, as soon as she saw me, she was like, are you Paula John's daughter? Anyway, and so she felt really bad and blah, blah, blah. It was all taken care of. But, like, I was on the phone for, three people.
Yeah. So I don't know if that word's, like, driven in general, but, like, persistent, driven, like, willing to get any job done. Mm-hmm. So whether that means standing up for
good or bad, hard to say. You make the call.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, twins will be twins.
Yeah.
I'm really glad that you're getting this job done.
Yeah.
Because I love having you guys be part of this, and it makes it just that much more fun and positive. And I don't want anyone out there to hire them because I want to keep them. They're too busy as it is, and they're so good at what they do, but I want to keep them.
If you ever hear sniffles in the back of the camera, it's us. Sniffling, crying.
Yeah, we've done one where we all cried at that one, but that hasn't aired yet. That'll be later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Okay. Do you want to sign off? I think we should do a new sign off on the soul booth. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I think that somebody said that this week, that Nancy, you need a special sign off.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, oh, well, how about what I use when I write my newsletter, which is just stay tuned. Which means what? It's a test. Stay tuned. It's not just a TV reference, which makes sense because I did a long time in TV, but it's about staying tuned, meaning in terms of your own frequency, you know, you can be, on the channel for the radio station, or it can be full of static and you can be struggling to tune it. And we are like that as humans, right?
I love that.
And we all have those days when we are just, it's all about the static and it's frustrating and irritating and we're anxious and whatever. And we have those days where the tuning is just perfect and it's sweet and we're happy and we feel grateful. And I just say, stay tuned. So go ahead. You sign off this time, please. Both of you. In twin mode.
Twin mode. You have to count us in.
On your, okay.
On your mark. Get set.
One, two, three, four.
Stay tuned. Baby.
See you next time in the soul booth.
Killing it.